It's great to be part of a credit union that professes our Catholic faith.
Oceanside Christopher is a Catholic credit union, and they care about the Catholic community on Long Island.
It's a community. You come here, you feel like you know everybody in here, you feel comfortable, and always get great service.
You don't get that feeling when you go somewhere else to a commercial bank or even another credit union for that matter.
You come in here, everybody knows your name. It's always a hassle-free environment, and it's just very enjoyable to do business here.
We love that we're always greeted by a smile. Everybody here is so nice. We love the hours, the local feel of it. It's just like being a part of home when we come here.
I love this place. It's because it's a natural place. I do my finances, but I also get to know my faith is being represented.
And when I use my Oceanside Christopher Visa card, a portion of my purchase goes to support Catholic parishes. Welcome to Everyday Faith Live. I'm Monsignor Jim Vlorn, joined by Sister Mary Alice Peel. In world news, there are only two Chaldean dioceses within the entire nation of the United States of America, the Chaldean Catholic Diocese of St. Peter the Apostle, based in San Diego, and the Eparchy of St. Thomas the Apostle, based in Detroit.
Chaldean Catholic Bishop of Detroit, Bishop Frank Calabat, has called upon Catholics in the U.S. and other Western nations to adopt parishes, adopt dioceses, and adopt people in order to let the people there know that the people here are thinking of them and praying for them and thanking them for keeping the faith alive. Calling upon prayer and advocacy, the bishop, who was born in Kuwait, asked Christians to speak up all the time on behalf of the Middle East Christians who are suffering greatly from the effects of the 2011 Arab Spring. He said, "If this is the spring, I'd hate to see the winter."
And that's the truth of what's going on in these areas. And again, I know we talk about this all the time, but this is the reality of what's happening, and you're just not hearing about it on the news. And that's why we feel obligated to tell you about this. You know?
And you know, the idea of it's being the winter is true. When you look at those pictures, it's desolate there now. There's the buildings are bombed out, the people are gone. And, you know, we do need to not only pray for them, but we do need to try to support them in any way that we can.
So important. The UN Food and Agricultural Organization and the Pontifical Council for the Pastoral Care of Migrants hosted a discussion this week on the exploitation of some workers in the fishing industry.
Cardinal Pietro Parolin, the Vatican Secretary of State, called upon all to work for the end of forced labor. He said, in responding to the needs of a changing world that is constantly seeking justice, solidarity, dignity, and respect for the rights of every human person, especially the weakest and most vulnerable, each of us is called to make their own contribution in proportion to their ability to free the slaves from the trade in humans, which is today practiced on a global scale.
You know, it's a funny thing that we're doing this story, Sister. The other night I was out to dinner and I had a piece of sea bass, you know? And we talked about that, like where this comes from and how much labor goes into this, and wondering, like, is there any, you know, exploited labor involved in this? We just don't know. And that's why these kinds of things are helpful to us. Right?
Well, that's exactly right. And, you know, often when you go to, like these, you see these nail salons that are around, and you see people there being sort of bust into the neighborhood to work there.
Yeah.
And you wonder where they come from.
Sure.
You wonder in these various hotels, you know, where do those people come from?
Yeah.
And you don't know. You just don't know how many of them have been trafficked. And then, of course, of the child trafficking and the sexual exploitation that goes on with human trafficking. It's horrendous. And yet, apparently, it's a big item here in the United States.
And it's part of what the UN is looking at, which is actually only going to help in the long run for us as a church to be able to respond to this as well, right?
Absolutely. And, you know, with the Long Island Railroad now, you hear all the time, you know, if you see something, say something. But how much more important if you see something here in this whole area? Say something.
Sure.
Bring it to the awareness. Question it.
Yeah, it's such an important part of our own faith life, too. Well, in other world news, Lebanon is one of the countries that welcomes the highest number of Syrian refugees, and as a result, so do its churches. Since 2011, Monsignor Justinos Boulos Safar, the Syriac Orthodox Patriarch of Antioch, has received hundreds of Christian refugees' families in his parish.
Christ now invites us to help these people because, as a church, our message and our mission is not only to preach the gospel in a non-practical way, but to preach it in a very practical way, and this means helping people in these cases.
He quickly had to use all his creativity to alleviate the needs of refugees who kept ringing at his door. This is why the bishop looks for resources in every area to give back some to those who have lost their sense of life. He does so by completing projects like this, a residence where up to 50 families can live.
Our church is not rich, but we have opened the doors of our house to all the refugees. We do what we can with the help of God.
Lebanon, however, is in the midst of a grave situation. The bishop says the Syrian war has had a severe impact on the economy of his country. Despite this, he says that as a Christian, his duty is to help. This example of generosity has also comforted the refugees spiritually.
A blessing is given to us by the people we help. It is not we who give them something. They are the blessing to us. That is why we thank God for this opportunity to put our faith into practice.
Also amidst the Christian refugees themselves are Syrian families who have fled from war or from the religious persecution from groups like Daesh.
Sono martiri vivi.
They are martyrs in life. They are martyrs in life. The church calls them confessors of the faith, those who have suffered persecution but have not abandoned their faith. They are true martyrs.
He says every day is living proof of how divine providence helps them, but he also recognizes the impact of human action. May the powerful cease to sell weapons, stop the war, and above all, help Christians not to abandon the land that sparked their faith in Jesus Christ.
I have a number of friends from Lebanon, and they tell me that Lebanon is almost unrecognizable at this point because of all of this. And the land that they left and their homeland is absolutely been destroyed, which is incredible.
It is. But notice how he said, when we help them, they are helping us.
Right.
You know, their thankfulness. And I'm thinking on this Thanksgiving weekend as we, you know, have given out all these baskets of food once a year. What are we doing to help others, because in not just once a year, but all the time. This throughout the world, there's so much suffering. Mm. And if we would only extend a hand, whether it be right here on Long Island or wherever we live, or in the rest of the world.
Sure, very, very important. And again, to even to pray for our Lebanese brothers and sisters who are going through so much pain and so much struggle. Once again, another place that is really struggling with religious liberty, and we don't hear about it on the news, so we hear about it here so that you can pray for them and we can take action together. Very important. In Vatican news, what is an apostolic letter? Well, an apostolic letter is a document of papal magisterium, less solemn than an encyclical, but of great importance. John Paul II published one after the closing of the Jubilee year in 2000.
The title translates to mercy and misery. St. Augustine used this expression to remember the scene of the gospel in which they wanted to stone an adulterous woman and Jesus forgives her. The main point is to do everything possible to make it easier for people to go to confession. There are many transformations. One, for example, is it will be easier to find priests available to hear confessions, because the sacrament should not only be a novelty. It proposes that each Catholic community dedicate one Sunday a year to renew its efforts to make the sacred scriptures better known and more widely diffused. He also instituted a World Day of the Poor to be held in all churches on the last Sunday before the Feast of Christ the King. From now on, all priests will be able to absolve the sin of abortion, both from the doctors performing it and the parents of the child. Previously, only bishops could absolve people from this sin. Pope Francis is maintaining the force of the Missionaries of Mercy, 1,000 priests from all over the world who can absolve these five sins reserved only to the Vatican. The violation of the secret of confession, the ordination of bishops without the approval of the Pope, the complexity of priests who propose sexual relations to another person and then confess of that sin, desecration of the Eucharist, violence against the Pope. Pope Francis returns to the main idea contained in the document Amoris Laetitia and asks the Church to regard all human problems from the standpoint of God's love, which never tires of welcoming and accompanying. Pope Francis reminds priests how they should care for those who want to return to the life of faith but are divorced and have remarried or live a delicate personal situation. It is a matter of exercising a careful, profound, and far-sighted spiritual discernment so that everyone, none excluded, can feel accepted by God, participate actively in the life of the community, and be part of that people of God which journeys tirelessly towards the fullness of his kingdom of justice, love, and forgiveness and mercy. The Pope shows that in addition to receiving mercy, it must be given. That means not being indifferent to the sufferings of people. He calls on Catholics to work to restore dignity to people, especially those who do not have work, do not have a house, are marginalized, are hungry, have to migrate, are in prison in inhumane conditions, or do not have access to education.
You can read this apostolic letter online. And also, this is sort of the takeaway from the Year of Mercy. This is sort of the Holy Father's gift to us to reflect on the Year of Mercy. Important note is on the forgiveness of the sin of an abortion. In the United States of America, priests have always been given that faculty to forgive that sin. So I know a number of folks have said to me, you know, was my sin forgiven years ago? Is it not valid? No, it is forgiven and it is valid. It's other parts of the world where people had to get special permission for that. So that's an important note.
That's extremely important, so yeah. People are clear about that. But the other thing that I find that we need to highlight is that idea of the dignity of those who suffer in any way. Mm-hmm. You know, we've had time in nursing homes in the past years, and the dignity of the person in a nursing home, the dignity of a person with severe disabilities, sometimes, you know, society casts them away. And what the Pope is saying, and I think certainly we as Christians need to do, is say, no, how would Jesus treat them? Mm-hmm. And he would embrace them. And I think that's something we need to continue to look at. Who are those who are in most need of Christ's mercy? And those are the ones we need to reach out to.
And that letter, again, just so you remember, it's available online. You can read it online if you just Google it. And it's a great letter of encouragement from the Holy Father as the Year of Mercy closes. Because I think sometimes we get in our mind, well, God's mercy is over now. We had that for a year. No, God's mercy is eternal, of course. And this letter helps us to see the many ways in which God's myriad ability to have mercy on us is shown and how we're called to show it upon one another, too. It's an important one. In national news, some are saying an Indiana mayor's decision to rename the city's Good Friday holiday in the name of inclusivity will end up marginalizing Christians. Mayor John Hamilton of Bloomington cited the city's diverse workforce and said changing the names of Good Friday and Columbus Day holidays would better reflect cultural sensitivity in the workplace.
The mayor said that diversity makes us stronger and more representative of the public we proudly serve. He continued, these updated names for 2 days of well-merited time off is another way we can demonstrate our commitment to inclusivity. Our city employees receive paid time off for both holidays. Good Friday will now be known as Spring Holiday, while Columbus Day will be changed to Fall Holiday.
Bill Donahue of the Catholic League for Religious and Civil Rights said the mayor opted to rename Good Friday Spring Holiday because he doesn't mind offending Christians. He said the name change excludes Christians by denying recognition of a central day in our religious calendar. Yeah, you know, a mayor can say whatever he wants. It's still a federal holiday, so sorry. But the other reality is that this is a sacred day to us. We're not going to rename any religious holiday for any faith. It just doesn't make any sense.
Absolutely.
What are we going to
call
Christmas?
And
you know,
again,
the snow holiday?
The idea about inclusivity is so well taken, isn't
yeah.
it? Yeah. What's wrong with saying this is a Christian holiday and it's good we all have it off?
And sometimes things just get extreme. And I think, like, our extreme sense of what's right and fair gets a little crazy.
Absolutely.
So don't worry, everybody. It's still going to be Good Friday around here and in our neck of the woods, too. We'll be fine.
Well, coming up next, Pope Francis' inspiring words to show kindness to refugees and how Catholic Charities sponsors a training program to help refugees settle in their new environment.
They'll test you. Try to break your will. But however loud the loudness gets, however many cheese puffs may fly. You're the driver, the one in control. Stand firm. Just wait. And move only when you hear the click that says they're buckled in for the drive. Never give up till they buckle up.
I just walked by and I said, "What's happening, guys?" They told me they were making music.
That I could play, so any chance to play at all, you know, that's my life. I love music.
Yeah, I saw it.
Welcome back to Everyday Faith Live. While some countries have closed their doors to those seeking a safe haven, Pope Francis has used and urged pilgrims in St. Peter's Square to show kindness to refugees.
C'era un rifugiato che cercava una strada e una signora gli si avvicinò. Dice, ma lei cerca qualcosa? Era senza scarpe quel rifugiato. E lui ha detto, io vorrei andare a San Pietro per entrare alla Porta Santa. E la signora pensò, ma non ha scarpe, come andremo camminando, no? E chiama un taxi. Ma quel migrante, quel rifugiato puzzava. E l'autista del taxi quasi non voleva che salisse, ma alla fine l'ha lasciato salire al taxi e la signora accanto a lui. E la signora gli domandò un po' della sua storia di rifugiato ed emigrante. Nel percorso del viaggio, 10 minuti fino ad arrivare qui, quest'uomo raccontò sua storia di dolore, di guerra, di fame e perché aveva fuggito dalla sua patria per migrare qui. Quando sono arrivati, la signora apre la borsa per pagare il tassista e il tassista, l'uomo, l'autista, che all'inizio non voleva che questo migrante salisse perché puzzava, le ha detto alla signora, no signora, sono io che devo pagare lei, perché lei mi ha fatto sentire una storia che mi ha cambiato il cuore. Questa signora sapeva cosa era il dolore di un migrante, perché aveva il sangue armeno e sapeva la sofferenza del suo popolo pure. Quando noi facciamo una cosa del genere, all'inizio ci rifiutiamo perché ci dà un po' di incomodità, ma puzza. Ma alla fine la storia ci profuma l'anima e ci fa cambiare. Pensate a questa storia e pensate cosa possiamo fare per i rifugiati.
I love that the Holy Father has these stories in his heart and is sharing them with thousands and thousands, ultimately millions and millions of people. And that is a very moving thing, don't you think? I mean,
well, as I was listening to it, I thought he lived that, you know, when he was bishop. He lived that. He was out there among the people. But I was also thinking of the importance of witnessing. I think that's what he was saying, that that woman was witnessing to being a migrant. Mm-hmm. And she saw the suffering of another. So she really witnessed to two men there, the taxi driver and the person who was smelling.
Yeah, sure,
you
sure.
know, both of them saw a different side of life yeah. when they finished. And so, again, how important that is to witness.
And again, part of this weekend is storytelling, isn't it? Part of Thanksgiving weekend and gathering with family is retelling the stories of family, retelling the stories that aren't always the most perfect ones, you know, about our lives, but nonetheless can be quite inspirational. So it's worth taking that time to share those stories and find that inspiration.
Excellent idea. Thank you. Catholic Charities of Louisville, Kentucky resettled close to 1,500 refugees last year alone. Through innovative programming, they are helping these newcomers to be self-sufficient within the first few months of their arrival. Urban Gardens is a culinary training program that teaches marketable job skills.
Clients come with nothing. We've had clients that have been released from an immigration jail from a very repressive government with just the clothes on their back. The true objective of our refugee resettlement program is for our clients to be self-sufficient.
Common Earth Gardens began in 2007, the idea being that a lot of refugees that are resettled in the United States come from very agrarian backgrounds. They're resettled a lot of times into a very small apartment with very little access to any green space, let alone space to grow food.
I grew up beans and tomatoes, kale, and banana squash. I sell some I eat, some little my relative, I give to my relative, can eat.
So we train students the basics of working in a commercial kitchen and help them find jobs in the food service industry upon graduation.
En este curso he aprendido sobre las normas de higiene y sobre los preparativos de la comida. O sea, normas en general, cómo preparar la comida, la temperatura, las condiciones que debe tener el local, la norma que debe tener uno al trabajar.
I like to cook. I can prepare salads. I can fry chicken, I can clean dishes.
They gain more confidence, just like I did. And it also helps them with their English. You know, they're taking English speaking class when they come in here, and the more we speak English to them, the more they'll understand, and they feel more comfortable around you.
Our clients come here to have a better life and they are willing to work for that better life. You can ask a mailman or a landlord. When refugees start moving into that neighborhood improves.
I think it really helps build our community and make a stronger community as a whole. You know, by helping people find jobs and gain the skills necessary for employment, you know, it just really helps improve our community in many different areas.
If I get much money, maybe I can open my own restaurant. Sometimes to teach people, and sometimes I can open my own cafeteria to sell.
It's that old story, you know, give someone a fish, they eat for a day. Teach someone to fish, they eat for a lifetime. That's exactly what that program's doing, right?
It's wonderful. And, you know, I was thinking of Catholic Charities throughout the country.
Sure.
Of how much good work they do. And as you're getting ready for the Christmas giving and you want to give money, give it to a Catholic organization. Less money is spent on administration in Catholic organizations than any.
Sure.
And again, look at the good work that we can do when we unite and do that together.
Coming up next, a friend of Pope Francis explains his vision of church unity right after this.
You can't text and pay attention to the world around you, and you definitely can't text and drive. Every year, deaths due to distracted and negligent driving are increasing. In fact, while drunk driving rates have dropped greatly, negligent driving fatalities have skyrocketed. Find out more at negligentdriving.com.
Grandpa, look what I got.
Let me see.
Oh, Dad, wait till you see the bike we got for Jake.
Hearing loss happens gradually with age, making it easy to ignore. Yet most older Americans aren't getting their hearing tested. Untreated hearing loss can keep your loved ones from enjoying what they cherish most.
Dad, can you hear me?
Don't let that happen. Speak up about hearing loss. You'll be glad you did.
Welcome back to Everyday Faith Live. Joe Tessini, a Pentecostal Christian, is founder of the Phoenix-based John 17 Movement, an ecumenical initiative about forming relationships and friendships among Christians, which Pope Francis has been very supportive of. Mr. Tessini explains his vision of church unity.
Christians have, for centuries, decided their unity based upon a systematic set of doctrines. We believe the calling the Lord has for us is to take the night, the last night of Jesus' life. And if you look at the Gospel of John, where it's elaborated, that he rose from the table and he had this awareness, he had this knowledge that he came from God, that he was returning to God, and that all power in the whole universe and authority was vested in him. And what does he do? He takes a servant's apron, he wraps it around him, and he starts and he kneels down and he washes his disciples' feet. And then he concludes that exercise, that example, by saying, "You're not blessed that you know this. You're not just blessed because you know this, so you could do a great teaching on servant leadership." Here we are, you know, this is the look at what Jesus did. He said, "No, you're blessed if you do it." So he brought us now into a relational context to say, the way I want you to deal with one another is to put on that apron and you approach each other at the feet and you begin to wash each other's feet. This is going to be the mark of my apostles. And we have in Pope Francis someone who, you know, just gives us that example on a daily basis.
And from his leadership, so many thousands and thousands of people wash the feet of others, literally in our church and in our faith. And again, we've seen that on this Thanksgiving weekend, haven't we? And the thousands of families that have been fed through the generosity of others. So that's what it's all about. Hey, the 18th Annual Telecare Award of Excellence Luncheon will take place on Monday, November 28th. This awards luncheon is one of our largest fundraising events of the year. This year, we're honoring Daniel Cardinal DiNardo and Roma Downey and Mark Burnett, and also founder of Cablevision, Charles D. Dolan. It's going to be a great luncheon. There's still some seats available. If you want, give us a call at Telecare, extension 148, or go to our website, and you can still come to this event. Now, we got a lot of good people going to be there. You're going to be there.
I'm looking forward to it. It's always a wonderful opportunity to get together with people who are really very supportive of Telecare, but then also to honor the people that you honor. And, of course, this year, you have the new president of the USCCB.
Exactly right. We lucked out. We rolled the dice that he would be elected, and he did get elected. So we have Cardinal DiNardo, which is such a great honor. We're glad he's coming. So thanks for being with us, everybody. For Sister Mary Alice Peel, I'm Monsignor Jim Vlaughn. From all of us at Telecare, remember, keep the everyday faith live. Have a great week, everybody, and God bless you. It's great to be part of a credit union that professes our Catholic faith.
I trust Oceanside Christopher because not only do they have, you know, the best interest for me as a member in mind, but just they're always people helping people.
I saw firsthand during Sandy how we took care of our members.
I was one of the flood victims, and at that time when it happened, I gave up hope.
We're very grateful that we have our faith in the church, and we also have our faith in the credit union.